On behalf of NASSCOM Center of Excellence and Telematics Wire, I'm delighted to welcome you all today at 5th edition of APAC's biggest connected and autonomous vehicle conference and exhibition, Connected Vehicle 2020. So let's start the day with the opening session, that is Connected, Clean and Smart, the backbone of future mobility. First of all, I would like to invite on stage Mr. Sudhanshu Mittal, CEO NASSCOM Center of Excellence. Mr. Sudhanshu Mittal. Now I'd like to invite Mr. Diego Graffi, CEO and MD, Piaggio Vehicles Private Limited. Mr. Diego Graffi, please welcome him. Now I'd like to call upon stage His Excellency Mr. Brendan Ward, the Ambassador of Ireland to India. Please welcome Mr. Brendan Ward. And now I'd like to call upon stage Mr. S.S. Gill, Senior VP and Head International Business, Company-Owned Retail, Non-Automotive Engines and Brand and Communications, V Commercial Vehicles. Mr. S.S. Gill. So now I'd like to request Mr. Sudhanshu Mittal to deliver the opening session, deliver the opening address. Please, sir.
Good morning. So, as we talk about the connectivity part, there are multiple facets to the connectivity, and as part of this opening session, I thought that I will not try to go deep into any of those different parts, but talk shortly about the innovation ecosystem, a little bit about how we are promoting that in the country, and touch upon some of the challenges which are there, which we see as NASSCOM in the domain of connectivity as far as the automotive world is concerned. So as NASSCOM, what our primary responsibility is to support the ecosystem, innovation ecosystem, which means that innovators in the form of individuals, institutes and the startups who are developing the innovative ecosystem and different type of support help which they need. That's what we provide in terms of funding, go-to-market activity, intellectual property rights activity, support, technical help also, and also most important part, how they can work with the established players to promote their solutions in the market. These are some of the areas in which NASSCOM, Center of Excellence for IoT and AI, moves or helps the innovator to promote the ecosystem. Now, when we try to look at the connectivity, especially connectivity in the automotive world, it is not something monolithic. For the layman, when they talk about connected car, they kind of end up visualizing a vehicle or purely autonomous, because somehow that is the image which has been created in the mind of the people at the for the layman, that a connected vehicle means almost an autonomous vehicle, which is running automatically on its own and taking care of everything. But then that is not what it is. The connectivity has multiple layers, and if you look at different type of solutions which are being displayed by the companies over here or the different partners and the people that who have been talking about this, there are multiple levels of connectivity, starting from the basics and then going advanced. But then there are challenges. So even the solutions which are available in the market, and there is adoption into that, but then when you talk to the users, they bring out their pain points. And some of the simple pain points which are there, so one of the most common solution which is there is the location tracking, the GPS-based solution which does the location tracking for a particular vehicle, and then there are so many different manner, different ways that it's in which its benefits are described. Now, it will work as, perfectly fine as long as nobody is trying to tamper with it. But if you look at the fleet operator, and that's a real life scenario which they have talked about, that they may have few thousand commercial vehicles which deliver their goods throughout the country. And one of the problems which they face is that the driver will simply remove the device, the tracking device, so it is switched off, and then take a detour to their native place, and then take a few hours break, and then come back to the road, reconnect it, and then drive like hell to complete their schedule and on time, thereby increasing the risk to the cargo as well as adversely impacting the condition. And he said, can the technologist solve this problem of mine? Now, I had talked to many of the solution providers, and actually this problem has come as a surprise to them. They have not even thought about that. So there is no solution, at least not that I have been able to come across. Similarly, other problem that they face is that suppose I have 2,000 trucks in my fleet. Now, some of them will be doing cross-country run and some of them will be doing regional runs. So I may have certain vehicles allocated for the regional areas. Now, the problem which I face is that in that scenario, I will be working with different solution providers. So, because the support of the solution which is adopted in my vehicle is a critical part of my overall technology usage. So for that, I may work with different solution providers who have strong base in different regions. So for eastern region, I may work with one solution provider. For western region, I may work with another one. For north, south, etc., like this. The problem is that all those solutions which are there, they do not talk to each other. Each one will be supplying their own device, a separate platform, which will be there in the cloud. And the answer will be that, okay, you go to this, you do this particular login, and you are able to see the dashboard in this particular format. So as a user, I do not have the consistency of format. All of the solutions look different to me, and they do not talk to each other, so I have to go and do individual check. Now, that's a problem for me. That's a serious problem for me. And as a result, the most that I will try to extract out of the solution will be basic level of tracking, nothing more than that. Whatever advanced features that you talk about the vehicle condition monitoring or other things which are there, I will not really bother about that because it's too big a pain for me to be able to use those. And the reason for that, this particular problem is very simple. There is no standardization. Everybody has done their own development. They have their own protocols. And as a result, the devices do not talk to each other. The platforms do not talk to each other. Look and feel is totally different for each one. Nobody has even tried to think about that particular problem. Now, there may be the resistance from each one that I want to kind of corner my customers. I don't want to be in a position where they are shared with some other solution provider and all. But then the problem is that the same thing is there with everybody. And by not coming across working together to create common standardization, what is being prevented is number one, adoption. That's very straightforward because then they are resistant to the adoption. The second part is that even after the adoption and the platform, there is opportunity for a whole lot of third-party players to come on board and develop services. So as a user, at least, if I want to adopt, I want to be able to buy the devices from wherever I want and have a single platform which has been supplied by somebody else, which is customized for all my specific needs, and all the devices are talking to that particular platform. Now, if we are able to have that situation or that kind of solution capabilities, then we'll see much less resistance to the adoption. There are other challenges also which are there, and one of them simply being that the users in this world are not that much technology savvy, but then that's a separate issue. The technical parts are there because of which users hesitate in going ahead with the adoption. The third problem, which again I have observed, is around the policy aspects. And the question there is very simple. Who owns my data? Now, all of the vehicles which are there today in the field, they all generate huge amount of data. Now, but then, and I have a car which generates data. I mean, we talk about all kind of conditioning data and everything, and it's there. But then I cannot access it. Only the OEM, the vehicle manufacturer, and their authorized dealers can access it. Now, of course, I totally understand that they will be extremely reluctant to have any unauthorized person access the ECU data or those detailed diagnostic data, which is anyway not relevant. But then, can there be an area in the form of policy that at least certain data about my vehicle is available to me in a standardized format? The solution developers also struggle with this part, that okay, I have the device connected on the OBD port and I'm able to get the data, but then how do I make sense of it? I'm getting all those bits and bytes from the ports, and how do I convert that into the readable format for the end user? Because they are all proprietary protocols. So this part goes into the policy aspect and perhaps the technology players need to come together. We see a whole lot of disparate thinking also even among the technology players. They have different views on that. But then again, the problem there is that if you do not have the data in the standard format, you are not able to offer the services which users will find attractive. You are blocked at the initial stages itself due to the proprietary nature of the solutions being designed and implemented. And of course, I don't want to really spend too much time. We all know about the threats of the cybersecurity aspect which are there. And obviously, as more and more data gets generated, the vehicles are going to be major attack vector for all the hackers. I mean, we have all this virus which was there, which blocked all the hospitals, and they had to pay the ransomware in the Bitcoin to be able to have access to their own data. I'm sure that similar kind of things will start happening once we have higher adoption of technology on the vehicles, generate more data which travels over the internet and into the public cloud. All those clouds will be again attack vectors, because not all of them will be very, very secure. Sometimes there may be some proprietary data collection methodology also. So all those will be there, and the challenges will be there as to how to make data accessible while at the same time keeping it secure. And of course, the other parts around the anonymity of the data, because it's always very, very useful. I mean, if I'm in a public service, or let's say as a politician, my vehicle movement may be of very, very interest to my opponents, especially during the election time or around the election time. So how do you make data available, but at the same time, keep it secure in terms of privacy aspects? Now, these are some of the challenges which I have come across as I talk to different players. Apart from this connectivity, next frontier is electric vehicles. And when we go towards the electric vehicles, apart from all these standard aspects of connectivity, it starts becoming a little bit more challenging there. Because if I take the simplest example of charging of a vehicle. Now, in this petrol and the diesel world, it is reasonably straightforward. How do we fill the tank? So the hole in the petrol tank is of standard size. For the petrol vehicle, it is this particular size. For the diesel vehicle, it is this particular size. The nozzle of the petrol petrol dispenser will not be able to enter into that of diesel vehicle. And as a result, that kind of mistakes will not happen. But then beyond that, there is nothing. Whether it's a small car or it's a large car, car having 25 liter tank or car having 50 liter tank or higher tank or whatever it is, the rate of dispensation of fuel is determined by the dispensing unit. It has nothing really to do with which vehicle it is, how much fuel it has, which type of fuel it is. It's nothing really to do with that. But in case of EV world, this will become different. One of the biggest challenges which is there, which is hindering the adoption of the electric vehicles, is the time that it takes to charge a battery. Now, there are different methodologies for charging the battery, and they have their pros and cons. So as we talk, we define them as the slow, medium, and fast charge. And fast charge, obviously, fastest way to charge the battery, but then at the same time, it has the adverse impact on the cell chemistry and the battery life. But it may be relevant or necessary in certain cases. And going forward, for the proper adoption of the electric vehicles, it is necessary that there should not be different type of chargers for different type of vehicles. I mean, if we are trying to build or visualize the construction of charging infrastructure throughout the country, we cannot say that we will have one type of charger for large batteries in the large cars, then other type of chargers for two-wheelers, and third type of chargers for the autos, and another type of chargers for the bus, or for the bus and trucks, it may still be a little bit different. But for a proper adoption, it is necessary that there is standardization of the charging circuitry and the interface from charger to the batteries, to the vehicle. Now, that this brings in its challenges. Depending upon the battery size and the amount of time that a user has, a user may want to go for a particular type of charging. So if I have a two-wheeler and I want to, and I have, let's say, time for doing the charging, I may opt for slow charging. That, okay, I will allow my vehicle to be parked here for 2 hours, and during those 2 hours it can be charged. So I want to be able to choose the option of slow charging. If, on the other hand, I am in hurry and I need to quickly get some battery charged and say that, okay, fine, I want to go for fast charging. Within 15 minutes, I expect that my battery will be charged by 50% or something like that, and so that I can be on my way. And I want to be able to choose the fast charging method. Now, how does the communication between the vehicle and the charger work to allow me to be able to choose my methodology? And this is the simplest scenario that I have talked about. As we go forward and try to get into the adoption, there are going to be many more complex scenarios coming out. But this is simplest. So the standardized mechanism between different vehicles, the battery management systems of the vehicles, and the charging infrastructure is going to be a serious challenge, or at least a necessity, if the proper adoption of the vehicles has to take place. And again, it will be the responsibility of the industry, because a whole lot of aspects there will be extremely technical, and the government is not necessarily the right player to be able to go into those technical aspects. It will be incumbent upon the industry itself to come together and help define this kind of standards and accept those. Again, not the proprietary thing, because this is my proprietary area and I want to be able to hold on to my customers because I have designed this. That's again going to hinder the adoption. So these are just some of the thoughts which I thought I will share as part of the opening session, that these are the challenges for connectivity part, and we look at the connectivity in different manner at different layers rather than a single monolithic field or domain. So I expect that going forward we will see a whole lot of new innovative solutions coming up addressing the real world challenges which are there and which are hindering or slowing down the technology adoption, and innovative solutions coming for those. Thank you very much. And if there are any questions, maybe if we have time later on, I will be happy to answer those. But thank you very much for your time.